the United States. In a few videos now, I've mentioned how the US bought a few significant parts of their territory. This topic was talked about a lot a few months ago when there were some news stories about the US wanting to buy Greenland. But while it sounds completely absurd to us today, for a country to buy land off another nation, this concept wasn't so crazy a few hundred years ago. And in fact, in the case of the US specifically, a very large percentage of its territory was, in fact, bought. The most well-known cases being Louisiana from France and Alaska from Russia. And when I say a large percentage, I mean it. The Louisiana Purchase granted the US an additional territory in the size of around 2.1 million square kilometers, nearly doubling their territory at the time and still accounting for over 20% of their current territory. And that is just one of the many purchases they did. So in this video, we're going to find out how the US bought most of its territory. Throughout history, the US have made several territorial acquisitions. Some were just like the Louisiana Purchase, in which a simple trade deal was done, territory for money, with it either being the US seeking out the purchase or another nation seeking the sale. But others were made somewhat differently, and resulted, for instance, of peace deals, in which it was determined that the US would be granted a territory, but would have to pay a specific amount of money as well. I am counting these as territorial purchases, because I think they are. The only difference is that a conflict, rather than the wish of a trade deal, led to the exchange of territory for money. To start things off, let's list out all the territorial purchases the US has made in its history so far, and then we can go one by one and briefly understand how and why they happened. The first land the US government ever bought was officially in 1776, a very small area where Fort Billingsport existed. Consisting of 96 acres or 0.4 square kilometers, its price was 600 British pounds, bought by the Continental Congress in order to be used in the American Revolutionary War. Next came the big one, and the first real territory buy, the Louisiana Purchase in 1803 for $15 million. Next was East and West Florida, ceded by Spain in exchange for $5 million in 1819. Then the Mexican Cession of 1848, during which the US also had to pay $15 million, even though it was a result of a US victory in a war against them and wouldn't have happened without that war and that victory, but they still paid a sum of money, so I'm including it. The Gadsden Purchase from Mexico for $10 million, an actual purchase in the perfect sense of the word. In fact, we can see it by the difference in the sum, $15 million for the Mexican cession of this gigantic territory and $10 million for the Gadsden Purchase of this small area, which shows us that the real cause behind the cession was in fact the victory in the war. Then came another big one, the Alaska Purchase of Russia in 1867 for $7.2 million. The Philippines were purchased from Spain for $20 million in 1898, however also being a result of the US winning the Spanish-American War. But for instance, this war also resulted in the cession of Puerto Rico and Guam from Spain to the US, and in those cases, money wasn't exchanged. So I think we can consider the Philippines as a partial purchase, just like the Mexican Cession. In 1903, they bought, or more accurately rented, the Panama Canal Zone from Panama for $10 million plus an annual fee of $250,000. Guantanamo was also bought slash rented off Cuba in the same year for $3,300 plus an annual rent of $2,000 initially and then $4,000 from 1974 onwards. The Danish Virgin Islands were bought in 1917 for $25 million. Keep in mind, money inflation is a thing, and so these 25 might not be worth as much as the initial 15 to buy Louisiana, although Louisiana's price was still ridiculously low at the time. And finally, the Water Island Purchase, an island adjacent to the Danish Virgin Islands, but which wasn't included in the initial deal because it was property of a private company, and it was bought in 1944 for $10,000. So if we add it up, the US spent around $107.3 million buying territory throughout its history. But we need to take into account the change in money value throughout the years. In a lot of cases, it's hard to do the conversion, but I used an online calculator and converted each value individually according to its date into what that money would be equivalent to today, and this price adds up to $2,831,245,000. $100,000, which is a lot more, but honestly still not that much for what amounts to around 54% of the current US territory. There were also other small purchases made, especially between the federal government and Native American tribes, such as the 1893 purchase of the Cherokee outlet in the Oklahoma Territory, the Platte purchase in 1839, buying 8,156 square kilometers of land in what is now Missouri from American Indian tribes for only $7,500, or the Phelps and Gorham purchase in 1788 of 24,000 square kilometers in what is now Western New York State from the Sioux Confederacy. In the Cherokee case, the US government failed to pay for the land until the 1880s and then paid less than the price asked by the Cherokees, and the Phelps and Gorham purchase was also paid only in 1/3 of the total value. There are many other small examples like these of native land being bought by the government, sadly with a lot of them having payments not being fulfilled. The remaining of the territory which wasn't purchased are the initial area of the first 13 colonies to become independent, which were initially just the coastal areas, but then expanded further after the Treaty of Paris of 1783, which brought peace between the US and Britain, also extending the western border of the US and doubling its territory at the time. The Oregon Territory, ceded to the US by Britain via a diplomatic treaty in 1846, which includes the current states of Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and parts of Montana and Wyoming, an area of North Dakota and Minnesota, which was also ceded by the British, two small additional Spanish cessions, the annexation of Texas and Hawaii, and other small territories which were acquired by annexation, cession, or diplomatic agreement, but without the exchange of money as far as I could find out. If I'm mistaken in anything throughout the video, feel free to point it out and let me know in the comments. We can therefore understand that since its independence in 1776, as the initial 13 colonies, the United States has grown and grown and grown by the expansion and acquisition of new territories. The satirical cartoon by artist Victor Gillam from 1899 shows the growth of America in size as it gained more and more land. If you know the shut up and take my money meme, I used it for the thumbnail and adapted it into Uncle Sam. I'm actually really proud that I was able to make this work because let's be honest, it looks amazing. But like I said, the point of this video is to understand the purchases. So now that we got a general idea of territorial expansion and we listed out the main purchases, let's go through those and understand why and how they happened. Going from the oldest to the most recent, the Louisiana Purchase. In 1803, in return for $15 million, equivalent to around $350 today, the United States acquired a total of 2.1 million square kilometers off of France. The French only actually controlled a small area within this territory, and the rest was inhabited by Native Americans, but was claimed by the French and belonged to them from the perspective of European colonizers. For the majority of the area, what the US was buying was the preemptive right to obtain Indian lands by treaty or by conquest to the exclusion of other colonial powers. It's estimated that the final cost of all subsequent treaties and financial settlements over this land has been around $2.6 billion, a lot more than those initial $15 million. Louisiana had been French land since 1699, then Spanish for some time, but regained by France in 1800 through the work of Napoleon and the desire to re-establish a North American colonial empire by the French. However, France's failure to put down a revolt in Saint-Domingue, along with the possibility of a new war against the UK, led Napoleon to sell Louisiana to the United States, which had been a long-term goal of President Thomas Jefferson. Although Jefferson only really wanted the port of New Orleans and not necessarily the entire gigantic territory, at this time, this purchase nearly doubled the size of the country overnight, including land from what are currently 15 different states, and even stretching a little bit into Canada, land which was then ceded to Britain in 1818. Then the Florida Purchase. The Florida Purchase Treaty, or the Adams-Onis Treaty, was signed in 1819 and settled a border dispute between the two countries. The Adams-Onis name is because of the two diplomats who negotiated it, John Quincy Adams by the US representing President James Monroe and Luis de Onis for Spain in representation of King Ferdinand VII. Essentially, Spain ceded its Florida colony to the US and the new United States boundary line was established. In return, the US paid $5 million, around $104 million in today's money, and relinquished claims on parts of Spanish Texas, which would have been American under the terms of the Louisiana Purchase, but which the Spanish still controlled and didn't agree to letting go of. Florida had become a burden to Spain. They couldn't afford to send settlers or garrisons, and so the Spanish government decided to cede the territory to the United States in exchange for solving the border disputes and the financial compensation. An interesting fact is that 183 days after the treaty was signed, Mexico became independent, taking control of all of these Spanish colonies in North America, forcing the US to sign a new treaty with the new Mexican Empire, the Treaty of Limits of 1828, to confirm the boundary line which had been agreed to with the Spanish. But a border issue with the Mexicans was soon to come as well, leading to the Mexican Cession. In 1846, the Mexican-American War started, due to the US annexation of Texas, which had previously been a Mexican territory, although the US partly also wanted to go to war to fulfill their idea of manifest destiny, which seeked the expansion of the United States to the rest of the American continent, especially towards the West. The US won the war, and because of that victory, they not only confirmed Texas as their territory, but gained a lot more. The Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo ended the conflict, determining the Texas-Mexico border as the Rio Grande, and granting the US a lot of land that was previously under Mexican rule, paying Mexico $15 million, $500 million today, for these territories, and consisting of the current states of California, Nevada, Utah, Arizona, and parts of Wyoming, Colorado, and New Mexico. Adjacent to the Mexican Cession came the land bought through the Gadsden Purchase, a 77,000 square kilometer area which is now located in Arizona and New Mexico, bought by the US from Mexico through the Treaty of Mesilla in 1854. The US bought this land for $10 million, around $314 today, because they wanted to use it to build a transcontinental railroad, although the purchase was also to solve a few border issues that existed in the area. Next in history was one of the biggest purchases and most well-known, the Alaska Purchase. The US bought Alaska off of the Russian Empire in 1867 for $7.2 million. This would be around $128 million in current values. Here we can see a scan of the actual check used to pay for it. Can you imagine this? Handing somebody a check and saying, okay, now you own this gigantic country-sized piece of land. Russia had established a colony in North America in the early 1700s, but very few Russians ever actually settled in Alaska, and the exploration of the territory was attributed to a single company, the Russian-American Company, which had the mission of establishing new settlements in Alaska, conducting trade with natives, and carrying out an expanded colonization program. But they weren't very successful. A fun fact, this was Russia's first joint stock company. Eventually, Russian Tsar Alexander II started thinking it was probably a good idea to sell Alaska, since it was so far away and would be difficult to defend from being conquered by Russia's arch-rival at the time, the United Kingdom. The purchase added over 1.5 million square kilometers of land to the United States. This amounts to around 21 cents per hectare, and apparently the American government thought Alaska would serve as a good outpost to establish more trade between them and Asian nations. Then came another purchase slash cession which followed a war, the Philippines Cession. The United States acquired the Philippines archipelago off of Spain as a result of the Spanish-American War. The war began in 1898, and there were many causes for it, but the main ones being the American support for Cuban and Filipino independence movements, as well as their desire to establish control or influence in those areas. The US won the war, and in the Treaty of Paris of 1898, which ended the conflict, Spain relinquished all claims over Cuba and also ceded Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines to the United States. The cession of the Philippines specifically involved a compensation of $20 million, $636 million today, from the US to Spain. Eventually, full independence was granted to the Philippines in 1946, and this territory is no longer part of the US, so a temporary territorial acquisition. Another temporary purchase slash renting was that of the Panama Canal. President Theodore Roosevelt, one of my favorite presidents, by the way, believed that a US-controlled canal over Central America was a vital strategic interest of the country, allowing a faster route between the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans and a closer sea path between the east and west coasts of the United States. He therefore encouraged the purchase of the French project to create a canal in Panama. They bought the land off the French for $40 million, but this was essentially a purchase of their project up to that point. The usage of the land by the US still had to be approved. Panama was a part of Colombia at the time, but the Colombians refused. So Roosevelt implied to Panama Panama rebels that if they were to revolt, the US Navy would aid them in their fight for independence. When Panama declared its independence in 1903, the USS Nashville stopped the Colombians from interfering. After this, the new Panama Nation gave the United States control of the Panama Canal Zone in 1904 for $10 million, worth around $300 in today's values, plus $250,000 a year as sort of a rent. But the Torrijos-Carter treaties that had established this deal already predicted an end to it, and so the Canal Zone was abolished in 1979, being put under joint US-Panama control until it was fully turned over to Panama in 1999. Another place where a yearly rent was part of the deal is the Guantanamo Purchase. It was first established in 1898 when the US took control of Cuba from Spain, eventually being officially leased from Cuba for use as a coaling station and naval base in 1903, and is now the oldest continuous overseas US naval base. The lease was initially $2,000 a year, paid in gold. In 1974, they updated it to $4,000. The initial payment they apparently had to put forward, sort of like a down payment, would be equivalent to around $100,000 today. Exactly why the US wanted this is something I couldn't find out, honestly. I think it was just a strategic base that they wanted to have in Cuba to serve their Caribbean Sea interests, and it happened to be there since the first Cuban president, Tomás Estrada Palma, offered a perpetual lease to the US if they wanted the area, with the deal being made official in the 1903 Cuban-American Treaty of Relations. And finally, the last of American territorial purchases, at least so far, the Danish Virgin Islands Purchase. The United States had been interested in these islands since at least the 1860s as a possible economic and national security asset, also having to do with their desire to expand and create what would essentially be their own colonial empire. In 1898, President Woodrow Wilson said, "We have left the continent, which has, until now, been our only field of action, and have gone out to the seas." Finally acting in 1917, because of the island's strategic position near the approach of the Panama Canal, and due to their fear that Germany might seize them and use them as submarine bases during World War I. So they agreed to a purchase, with the US paying Denmark $25 million in gold coins, equivalent to $499 million in today's value. At the time of this purchase, the Danish colony did not include the adjacent water island, which had been sold by Denmark to the East Asiatic Company, a private shipping company based in Denmark, in 1905. The company eventually sold the island to the US in 1944 during the German occupation of Denmark, for a value that would be equivalent to around $145,000 today, $10,000 at the time. Not to mention the various other very small land purchases that were sometimes made, the numerous lands that the US bought from Native Americans, sometimes in awful and even unfulfilled terms, and also the internal purchases, which states sometimes made between each other or between themselves and the federal government, although those didn't expand the country's territory, but simply reorganized it. So, that is a brief overview of how the United States bought most of its territory, from that small fort in 1776 to the large areas of Louisiana or Alaska, to the partial purchases which resulted from military victories, but still saw the exchange of money like the Mexican cession or the Philippine cession, or the logistic purchases in order to fulfill economic or infrastructure projects like the Gadsden Purchase or the renting of the Panama Canal. Thanks so much for watching this video. Leave a comment if you notice any mistakes, or if you have any additional information about these, or if there was any land purchase that I missed and forgot to mention, or just let me know your opinion about this topic. Remember to subscribe if you want to catch future videos, and I will see you next time for more general knowledge.